Joining us now to break down the drama and the progress of the government's response is Jennifer Franco, an anchor reporter here at One America News who's on the congressional beat. So, Jennifer, we saw Thomas Massie right there. He was almost the last hiccup. People were kind of scared that maybe he would be delaying this. And, of course, I just want to highlight for our viewers what that means. That means that a lot of people who are going without paychecks right now would go another day or a couple days without getting that much-needed relief and assistance. So what exactly was Representative Massie complaining about?
Yeah, so Congressman Massie's move wasn't necessarily a surprise to his colleagues. He's known to be a fiscal hawk. So he opposed this massive legislation on two grounds, constitutional grounds and fiscal grounds. Like you mentioned, that big price tag, he took a big issue with that price tag, and he just said that it was a lot of money to greenlight, with considering the fact that not all of the House was present for the vote. So that's what he was calling for, rather than having a voice vote, how it got passed in the lower chamber. He wanted to do a roll call vote. And so essentially, you know, we had House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy and House Speaker Nancy Pelosi on the phone late Thursday night, early this morning, making sure that they had the 216 lawmakers present there in order to block Massie, as we saw ultimately happen. And then, of course, sending the legislation to President Trump's desk for his signature, which, as we know, the president approved that as well. But he really just took issue with those two main things. He's known as an ideological hawk fiscally, and he like that soundbite that you played there, he just wasn't going to let his principles by the wayside, even though we're in a pandemic right now.
Right. And a lot of people would almost compare him to kind of the Rand Paul in the House a little bit, someone who kind of sticks to that ideological principle, of course.
And they're both from Kentucky, so.
There you go. And, of course, Rand Paul, too, unable to vote in the Senate earlier this week because he's at home quarantining. So it's really an unprecedented time. And, of course, there's the House was on recess this week, another bizarre thing during the middle of an emergency. They're not allowed to remote vote. That's something that's being debated by lawmakers as to what they can do moving forward. But I want to stick on Massie for a second because it was a rare sign of kind of bipartisan criticism. We saw people on the right and the left kind of coming at him during this emergency time. What were those reactions?
Well, aside from the biggest reaction that we saw from President Trump, which you highlighted there, and actually Massie did kind of clap back on Twitter, and he told the president via Twitter that he's at least a second tier
grandstander.
Grandstander. Thank you. Kind of that clap back there from Massie. But we also saw some criticism, like you mentioned, from other lawmakers. Peter King, a Republican from New York, called him out for essentially having the vast majority of lawmakers that were supposed to stay at home and abide by these government guidelines, they were forced to fly to D.C. And so not only did King call him out for putting the legislation at risk of being delayed from passing and getting that money to Americans, but he also called him out for putting his fellow colleagues' health on the line.
No, and there was also John Kerry, and he had a kind of a weird response. It's something that you don't see very often. In fact, he basically said something. I can't even repeat the language on air because it was kind of a
derogatory play on Massie's name. We'll put it that way.
Yes. It was a very aggressive type of response. But it actually got a response then from President Trump, who was kind of like, wow, I can't believe I'm agreeing with John Kerry right now. It's kind of an interesting type of thing to see two very prominent people on two separate sides of the aisle coming at this representative in this way. But now we're past that. The bill has passed. It's going to President Trump's desk for signature. He's going to sign it. It goes into law. That's what's happening. Are we done with this? There's been some speculation that this shutdown could go on to Easter, maybe longer. No one knows at this point. Are we done with these bills coming out of Congress?
So it looks unlikely, actually, that we're done with that. So, and it depends who you ask as well. But actually, I did speak with Congressman Mike Waltz of Florida earlier today, and he said that there's very much so been talk in the House, especially coming from House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, about a phase four. So what's getting through Congress now is considered phase three. And as you might remember, when there was a back and forth between Senate and the House, Speaker Pelosi had floated a bill that was over 1,000 pages long, basically with Democrats' wish list of things that they wanted to get passed in phase three. And a lot of it was not related to the COVID-19 pandemic at all. So what we might be seeing, considering that there is talk about this, we might see Democrats try to push for some of those agenda items to be addressed in a possible phase four. So things that might be included in that boosted infrastructure spending, expanded Social Security benefits. Zoe Lofgren, a California congresswoman, also has been talking about pushing through a federal mandate to make it so that states have to offer vote by mail or other remote options for the presidential election. But I do want to point out that in phase three, the Democrats did get $400 million of funding for election assistance. And what they're asking for, if they were to push for that again in a phase four, that would cost $4 billion. So just to put that into perspective as far as dollar signs go. You know, and then you go to the Republicans, of course, and they very much had their opposition to some of what got passed in the bill. But at the end of the day, Mitch McConnell was able to get everyone on board, and they all pushed this, knowing that this was going to benefit Americans. And right. If you ask somebody like Kevin McCarthy from California, the House Minority Leader, he's saying talk about a phase four. It's a little too soon for him. He's saying let's wait and see how phase three plays out, how this shakes out. And, you know, we're going to start seeing Americans receive that $1,200 in their bank accounts by early April. Let's see how this shakes out, and we'll go from there.
No, good news there. And regarding the voting, too, I think it's kind of interesting that Democrats are kind of pushing these voting reforms a little bit, because this is more going to affect them. They're the ones holding the primary race right now. A lot of people very critical of, for example, of states like Illinois holding their primary race, gathering people together, despite the CDC guidelines saying don't have these big events of 50 or plus more, now 10 or plus more. It kind of goes against all the guidelines that public health officials are saying. So I think that is why the voting is playing into it. But once again, we'll be catching up with you. I'm sure there'll be more progress from the government regarding this. Jennifer Franco, you've done a great job covering this beat. Thank you.
Thank you.